Welcome to Sound Bites, hosted by registered dietitian nutritionist Melissa Joy Dobbins.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the Sound Bites podcast. This is a three-part series on umami and MSG, or monosodium glutamate. I'm interviewing four different experts on the history, the science, and the culinary applications of MSG and umami. Now, MSG is one of the most beloved and demonized ingredients in American history. It's a staple for home cooks and world-renowned chefs, yet it's a subject of skepticism as brands and restaurants promote quote-unquote MSG-free foods and dishes. Back in September, I was invited to attend the World Umami Forum in New York City, an event hosted by Ajinomoto, the world's first and leading manufacturer of MSG. What I learned there was so compelling that I decided to do a series of episodes so that I could interview several of the speakers and experts that I met at the conference and bring their knowledge and their stories to you. You'll hear from a food historian and author, a registered dietitian, a research and food industry scientist, and also a chef. Now, in this series, we explore the largely untold history, the research on the safety, the culinary applications, and even some potential health benefits and current research approaches, and what you learn may surprise you. There's quite a story to be told here. Now, while we are going to explore these topics in depth, I want to share some top-line information with you now. First, MSG, or monosodium glutamate, is a seasoning that combines sodium with glutamate, which is an amino acid that is naturally present in certain foods. Two, MSG is the purest form of umami, which is one of the five tastes in addition to sweet, salty, sour, and bitter, and it brings out the savory flavor in foods. And three, replacing one-third of the table salt in a recipe with MSG can reduce the sodium by up to 40%. In fact, the Institute of Medicine has referenced the potential of MSG as a tool to reduce sodium in foods. So in these three episodes and four interviews, we cover a great deal of information. However, we did not discuss where you can purchase MSG. So I want you to know that it's sold under the brand name Accent in the United States, as well as Ajinomoto, and can be purchased in the spice aisle of most major supermarkets, also Asian grocery stores, and of course, online. I want to thank Ajinomoto for inviting me to the World Umami Forum and for their support and sponsorship of this podcast series. I hope you enjoy listening and learning all about MSG and umami. For more information and resources, you can visit my show notes at soundbitesrd.com and also the website whyusemsg.com. Enjoy the series. Hello, and welcome back to the Soundbites podcast. You know who I am, and you know what I stand for. And this is a three-part series on umami and MSG, or monosodium glutamate. And today's guest is Sarah Lohman. She is a culinary historian and the author of the book, Eight Flavors, The Untold Story of American Cuisine, which, by the way, is the number one bestseller on Amazon, and The Atlantic called it richly researched, intriguing, and cleverly written. So welcome to the show, Sarah.
Thank you so much. It's so nice to be talking to you.
Yes, I think you recall we met briefly. I saw you present at the World Umami Forum in New York City, and I just had to come up and introduce myself to you afterwards. When I saw you present, I just really enjoyed your energy and information that you shared. Was I had never really thought about things that way before. I was fascinated with your book, and we chatted a little bit, and now it's kind of coming full circle with having you on the podcast. Now, you focus on the history of American food as a way to access stories of women, immigrants, and people of color, and to address issues of racism, sexism, and xenophobia. So we're going to talk about your book and MSG and Umami, but maybe you can tell us a little bit more about your fascinating job in life as a culinary historian or a historical gastronomist, I guess.
Sure.
And also kind of what prompted you to write this book. And I'm going to say you had the most fascinating sounding summer job that had a really big impact on you. So please tell us.
I did. Well, at the time when I started it, I didn't think it was fascinating. Basically, when I turned 16, my mom told me I had to get a job over the summer. And she was working at a local living history museum in Ohio. If anyone's not familiar with living history, it was made famous by Plymouth Plantation. It's people in costume, in character, and it's a way of experiencing history that involves all of your senses, that helps to elicit empathy, and I think most importantly, reminds people that the past was full of people. You know, it can be really hard to get that sense when you're reading about something in a book. But museums that do living history try to offer something of a 360 experience of a different place and time, a moment in history. So I, you know, rather would have worked at the mall with my friends, or so I thought, but I ended up being at this job for about 3.5 years, every summer and some winters too, and some other bits and pieces here and there. And I just work with some really incredible people who are so passionate and just really awakened both this love and understanding of what's known as social history, looking at the past through its people. And one of the things that we did at this museum was we cooked on a cast iron wood burning stove. And not only was I sort of fascinated with the process of this particular tool, the stove, but we worked with recipes from the time period we focused on, which was the 1840s. After that job, a little bit during, I went to art school, and I just felt like my idea of what I wanted to look into kept coming back into the reinterpretation of history. And actually, for my thesis, I presented a pop-up restaurant that was fully operational for a week, and it presented cuisine from the colonial era for a contemporary audience. Mm-hmm. Even afterwards, when I moved to New York and I began working for Grub Street, New York Magazine, I got into the New York food scene, and it was very much at a time when what I would call foodie culture was beginning, and social media and blogging was very, very new. And I just saw that people were interested in the stories behind their food. So in 2008, I think, it's been so long, December 2008, I launched my blog, 4 Pounds Flour, and started by just looking at historical recipes for food and drink and recreating them because I wanted to know what they tasted like. But I found that when I would do that and share it with others, people started naturally asking questions. Mm-hmm. And it just seemed to me to be this really nice entryway to make people comfortable and get them to open up and talk about issues within America's past and present that are often uncomfortable issues to talk about. While I was in New York, I also worked at the Lower East Side Tenement Museum for 8 years. My last position there was the curator of their culinary programming. And so I, in particular, began to focus on immigration history in America. Immigrants have shaped American cuisine. And I think more importantly, we can look at American cuisine to understand our country as an immigrant nation. Mm-hmm. That there are other components of that and other people that have lived here. But specifically in 8 Flavors, I look a lot at American history and how it has been shaped by all the different groups of people that have moved here, that have lived here. So that's a brief history of where I came from and what I do and the sort of things that I work on.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I mean, you call yourself a performer because you perform across the country.
Yeah.
As a solo artist and also as part of the Masters of Social Gastronomy.
Yeah.
You do events and you teach classes from open fire cooking to food tours. And you also, I found this very interesting, you appeared in 2 seasons of the Cooking Channel's Food Fact or Fiction. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I was lucky enough to do 2 seasons of Food Fact or Fiction, which is a show that just sort of picks a food and investigates the history behind it. Just in general, I love communicating with people. I've always been an educator. My background is very much in public history, from my museum job in high school to all my years at the Tenement Museum. So to me, it's really important, I feel, to take information and communicate it to a very broad audience. And just for me, I really like connecting with people in person. So what I essentially do as a culinary historian is sometimes I write, like today, and then next week I'm going into New York City and doing a series of events. And some of them are just small cooking classes that are fun for me to teach. And then I have a monthly engagement at Caveat, which is in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. And that's a master's in social gastronomy. I have a teaching partner, Jonathan Soma, who is a resident food scientist. And we pick a topic and pair up and investigate the social history and science and culture behind that topic. So it's very satisfying to me. It's really, really fun to investigate the topics. We also do that as a podcast too. So if you just look up Master's Social Gastronomy, any of the podcasting apps, especially iTunes, it'll come up, and it is a couple months delay, but a recording of the live show that we do at Caveat. So I work a lot out of New York, but especially when the book came out, I was also traveling nationally, and I've done talks literally coast to coast about different chapters from my book or different topics that I've researched for fun. We'll see in 2019. I've got some other cool potential projects in the works.
Mm-hmm.
Writing, talking, performing, it's a little bit hard to define what I do in just one word.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, maybe we'll come up with a new term for you. And I noticed at the end of your book, Eight Flavors, you talk about what the ninth one might be. And so it would be interesting to see if you do a sequel. Thank you for kind of painting that picture for us about the work that you do and how that obviously led to this idea for this book. What are the eight flavors, and how did you choose, or as you say, discover them?
So the eight flavors that I decided to include in my book are in chapters chronological to when they came into the American pantry and sort of stayed, like when did they arrive? So in chronological order, it's black pepper, vanilla, chili powder, curry powder, soy sauce, garlic, monosodium glutamate or MSG, and sriracha. And I put this list together. In the beginning, it was inspired by the idea of vanilla. I just noticed one day that, I spent all those years at a museum working in the 1840s, and it suddenly occurred to me that none of those recipes included vanilla extract. Mm-hmm. There weren't cakes that had vanilla extract in it, and that seems so strange to us today. Mm-hmm. So I really had this moment of like, okay, there must have been a turning point. Something happened for us to go from the 1840s, there's no vanilla, and then, okay, so when did we start using vanilla? So I have a pretty extensive cookbook collection that ranges from reprints from the 18th century and originals really from, I think my earliest is in the 1870s is my current earliest original book. And then I have, you know, cookbooks all the way up to the contemporary. So I really just started pulling down these cookbooks. I have them arranged chronologically so I can have an understanding of what people were eating in certain time periods. And, you know, no vanilla before the 1840s. Vanilla is everywhere by the 1890s. Okay, what happened in there? And so I then used these cookbooks and just began writing down the prominent flavors of food in different eras, what ingredients were being used, what spices, what additives to flavor our food. I originally had a list of about 50, and then I began to narrow it down, like looking at things like garlic and oregano. These are things that were both brought in by Italian immigrants, too. So a little bit of parsley, things like that. So there'd be like groupings of different herbs, but out of that grouping, garlic was the most popular, and it's also the most highly flavored, and it has, I think it was the most representative of that shift in American food as millions of Italian immigrants came here. So I could kind of group things and then select the one that best told the story. Mm. And then it just, again, also sort of fell into place chronologically, looking at how big cultural shifts were happening in America, that there often was a change reflected in food and flavor. So I started with those cookbooks. I used a tool called the Google Ngram Viewer, which you can enter a search term in, and it plots the occurrence of that word over, you know, the years that you set in all of the books that Google has scanned. So all of the millions of volumes of text. So I could set it for America. I could set it for America of the last 150 years. And I could actually then visualize how often words like garlic or sriracha were appearing in texts over time. That let me not only determine which of these flavors were the most popular compared to their counterparts, but also you can visually see when new foods are arriving based on how frequently it's used in different time periods, which I think is fascinating. So that's my sort of convoluted system that then landed on, I use a combination of that and also just, okay, so what are the stories here? What does this say about us? To decide which ones I was going to put in my book.
Right, because in the book, you really say it's not so much about flavors, but about people and culture and history. So why did MSG end up being one of the eight? Tell us about that.
So I decided to add MSG into the book, no pun intended, I guess, adding MSG. it just seemed like a very natural fit at that moment, because to me, it represents a shift in food in terms of how we're creating food and what we're adding to it. And, you know, it's seen as this food additive, and it's seen as this symbol of the beginning of the age of processed food. And so I think it's really important to address controversial things like processed food and its role in America, because it is a big part of American culture, good or bad. And I wanted to sort of fairly investigate the ideas of good and bad and what are the cultural implications of good and bad. So I knew I wanted to include that. But I also had heard that the idea of Chinese restaurant syndrome, what is popularly called the symptoms one gets after eating MSG-laden Chinese takeout, or really MSG at all from any source, the so-called Chinese restaurant syndrome. I wanted to investigate this syndrome and the supposed bad side effects of consuming MSG, because I had begun to hear a lot of rumblings that it just wasn't factual. And the more I read about it, it didn't seem to have any basis in truth, but I noticed that people had a very emotional reaction to the idea of consuming MSG. It was very, very negative, but when pressed as to why MSG was bad for you, people didn't really know. They just had the sense that MSG was bad for you. So I wanted to pick apart that whole idea, especially since what we call this mystery syndrome was Chinese restaurant syndrome, which didn't sit well with me in the first place. So the journalist in me could just smell that there was a story there, and I felt one that needed to be told really fairly, and one that really, really looked at the facts. So in the end, I decided to lay out an argument that said, MSG is not bad for you, here's why, but also here's how we got to the place that we believe that it is. Because I also think that that's always important to analyze. Why did we feel that way? Why do we feel this way? But also, here's why we shouldn't have this prejudice.
It's kind of genius, can I say, from a scientist standpoint, because we we just talk to people all the time about, you know, and of course, facts alone are not enough. And health professionals are getting better at communicating and connecting with consumers on a more emotional level. And certainly from a healthcare standpoint, you know, we do motivational interviewing versus just here's the facts, here's your education, here's your sample menu sort of a thing. But my brain is going because I'm like, oh my gosh, I wonder what if we looked at the full story of other foods that are or ingredients that are quote unquote seem bad or negative or there's resistance to. I just think it helps us address it from a different standpoint and gets us away from just looking at here's what the research says and, you know, the facts sort of thing.
Yeah.
But yet the story is factual too. It's not just the science facts or the food and nutrition facts. Like you said, how did we get here? So I love this. And when you shared it at the forum, you had me at MSG, you had me at Umami.
You know, I think there's really something to what you're saying there, because I think that I come from a family of scientists. So I'm often frustrated at how when it comes to food, people seem to really dismiss a lot of science facts. There's a lot of emotion involved in food. And I also know from coming from a family of scientists that scientists are not always the best communicators. So I think science education is really important. But I think addressing... Let me say this. I was really nervous about putting this chapter out there because, as I'm sure you've probably had experience with, people can get really angry about emotional beliefs that they hold to be true when you counter that with something, even if it's factual. And so I was expecting a lot of pushback. And much to my surprise, that's not what happened. I had managed to lay out my argument in an organized way that people could understand, it actually has changed people's minds. Mm. I've gotten a lot of feedback on that chapter, both friends and strangers, saying, you know, I read this and I really analyzed what I thought, and that's so silly. And even if they're just saying, you know, I don't think this is going to make me eat MSG, again, that's not important. Mm-hmm. What's important is sort of dispelling ignorance, dispelling a myth, opening people's minds to being more open to scientific understanding. And in the case of MSG specifically, really revealing that our negative ideas of MSG as a health crisis is actually tied into much older ideas of xenophobia and racism, which to me was really apparent right there in its name, Chinese restaurant syndrome. We're blaming a culture for a syndrome, for a disease.
Absolutely. And that was going to be one of my questions for you is how do people react to your thoughts on MSG or food history perspective in general? So I'm really glad to hear that you've had such a great response, because it does seem to make sense both in my head and in my heart that if people do have a better understanding of how we got here, that it can help them, like you said, be more open-minded. And that's what I try to do on the show, is just help people think about something in a different way. And that's why this really got me. You've touched on this a couple of times, but I would like to delve more into it with regard to the racism and the xenophobia. Mm-hmm. And you can share a little bit more specifically about the history that launched this whole, it was like the perfect storm for Chinese restaurant syndrome to come along or to be named that. So would you tell us more about that?
Sure. So let me give you a little bit more context to begin with, that something we tend to do, I think not just in American culture, but as far as like tribalism and identity worldwide, is we do what I've heard called, we yuck someone's yum, right? Something that is delicious to one person is ew gross to another person. And a lot of times that idea of ew gross, you know, why do we find a certain food or food practice disgusting? It's often not because that food is inherently gross. Certainly it's not gross to that other culture. It's often for a process of both othering and sort of establishing your own tribe. Well, I don't eat that. They do, and they're gross. Mm-hmm. So there is a pretty consistent history within America of generalizing people, new groups of immigrants in particular, by their food, and basically saying that that food is disgusting, and it's representative of how disgusting those people are. So there's that precedent, one. Two, when we look at the arrival of Chinese immigrants coming in large numbers in the middle of the 19th century, there was a lot of prejudice in America towards Chinese immigrants. These were some of the first immigrants within our country that were not white, that were not white Europeans. And even that idea of white has changed over time. So it's a difficult one to use, but it's our first big immigrant group that was coming from Asia and looked different from the idea of an American, quote unquote, within the 19th century. And so this group was othered in many ways, including reports of what they ate. And it was fairly common in a slew of other sort of xenophobic or racist comments to say that Chinese people in America were cooking rats and cats in their food. Mm. And there was even, I read an investigative journalist, a neighbor was complaining that his Chinese neighbors were cooking rats and cats. So the journalist actually went and talked to these guys, and they were actually vegetarian. Mm. So they weren't actually eating any kind of meat. But it's that idea of, well, this community is so different and so ignorant and so disgusting that you have to be careful because they're going to cook you a cat. Mm. So that's how we're talking about Chinese communities within the 19th century. So monosodium glutamate is invented not in China, but in Japan at the turn of the 20th century, and eventually finds its way into mainland China through Taiwan, which was occupied by the Japanese for the first half of the 20th century. So they introduce MSG into Taiwan, it goes to the Chinese mainland, and it probably came to America with Chinese immigrants in the early 20th century. The first really clear evidence we have of it within American cooking is in a cookbook that is a Chinese cookbook, but is published in English for American audiences in the 1930s. And it refers to monosodium glutamate as being one of the five basic Chinese spices essential to cooking proper Chinese cuisine. At almost the same time, we see monosodium glutamate being introduced to American processed food manufacturers. And the consumption of MSG increases by tens of thousands of tons between the 30s and the 1960s as we increase the production of processed, canned, and frozen foods. So even though it is appearing within Chinese culture, the big consumers of and users of monosodium glutamate MSG within America were the processed food makers, the industrialized food makers. In 68, a letter is written to the New England Journal of Medicine by a doctor who is from China and is in America, and he notes that when he goes to eat Chinese food within America, he often doesn't feel well afterwards. And he lists four different reasons why that might be true. He says maybe it's the soy sauce, maybe it's because there's a lot of salt, maybe because they tend to use a lot of rice-based alcohol, or maybe it's the MSG. Is there anyone out there who has a research institute with the funds to look into this? So what's interesting is studies do happen after that moment, after that letter is published, that letter to the editor. But instead of discovering what the cause of an illness after consuming Chinese food might be, it assumes that monosodium glutamate is the villain in the situation. Mm-hmm. And so that kind of brings the third point of context, and that is that we've now, at this point, 1970, developed a fear of science. At the turn of the 20th century, science was going to solve all of our problems. But since that point, the change really began when we dropped the atomic bomb in Japan, and we could really see the horrors that science wrought upon the world. We also had just gone through the thalidomide scandal, which thalidomide is a morning sickness drug that created severe birth defects. And it was not approved in America, but was in Europe and in Australia. And around this time, too, we also banned cyclamate, which is an artificial sweetener. So we're really taking a more closer look at science and then particularly at food additives. So when someone raises a question of, hey, I'm eating this food and it's not making me feel well, all eyes are turned immediately to MSG. And because it was brought up within the context of eating Chinese food, that's when it gets the name Chinese restaurant syndrome. And pretty soon after, as this is gaining more and more public attention, that's when you start to see signs popping up outside of Chinese restaurants that says no MSG, no MSG.
Right.
I know that's so much, but that's sort of the introduction to the story, looking at, okay, how were we as a culture right for this moment? We're afraid of science. And we also have this history of blaming immigrant groups for our physical ails. I should say, too, that at the turn of the century, we blamed polio and Italian immigrants and tuberculosis on Jewish immigrants.
Wow.
So bringing up an idea of Chinese restaurant syndrome, of blaming a disease on a group of immigrants, was also not a new idea within American culture, unfortunately.
Wow. Thank you. That was the perfect, well-rounded, like you said, the three points that kind of one thing was sort of leading to the other, or other things that were going on at the time, the wrong ingredients together. And you're right, it was 1968 that that letter to the editor was in the New England Journal of Medicine. And thank you for bringing in the fact, because they talked about this at the forum as well, with us developing this fear of science.
Yeah.
So I think that is really key. So thank you. With MSG and the monosodium glutamate and it being a flavor enhancer, that brings us back to the eight flavors.
Yeah.
And how MSG produces this flavor of umami.
Right.
Which we say is one of the five tastes. So we've got sweet, salty, sour, bitter, and umami. So from a flavor standpoint, could you talk a little bit about umami and what that is and how that manifests itself in different foods, whether it's naturally occurring or it's added through monosodium glutamate, and from a flavor or culinary perspective, what you're seeing in America?
Yeah, absolutely. So relatively recently, since the early 2000s, we've introduced this fifth taste, the idea of umami, which is a Japanese word. And we essentially translate it, the flavor is savory, super savory. But the word was coined to describe the flavor of monosodium glutamate, of MSG, when it was discovered in Japan in the early 20th century. So it's a word that's been around a long time, and it is directly associated with MSG. However, that is definitely not how the word is being used within modern culture. You see it used in this very high-end context, right? Umami is what chefs use to create layers of savory food. So this idea of savory has existed in both Western and Eastern cuisine for a very long time. I find it extremely prominent within Japanese food. So in a way, it makes sense that MSG came from that culture. In that a backbone of a lot of Japanese food is a broth called kombu dashi that is made from a kelp that's harvested sort of in the North Seas of Japan. And this kelp has a very, very high amount of naturally occurring glutamic acid. And of course, also comes from the ocean, so it's covered in a lot of sea salt. And anyone is wondering what MSG actually is, it's glutamic acid, which is an amino acid, plus sea salt. And that's it. They're in an ionic bond, which just like table salt means that they crystallize. But then when they're added to water, in the case of monosodium glutamate, the glutamic acid and the sodium separate again and then can recrystallize. They come together and apart very, very easily. So you see that glutamic acid and sodium creating that savory flavor within kombu dashi. You also see it in things like bonito, the cured fish. You also see it then in other Eastern cuisine like soy sauce and then also fish sauce too. So we're looking at foods in that case that are fermented, and the fermentation process creates these amino acids, glutamic acid, and then a lot of salt is added to it. So again, naturally occurring MSG. Cured meats around the world often have high amounts of glutamic acid and usually salt. In Japan, again, bonito, but if we look at things like cured hams and cured meats from Europe, we see the same things, glutamic acid and then sodium too. Tomatoes are very high in glutamic acid, though. You know, when you have a nice ripe tomato, the first thing you might taste is sweet, but then the longer you chew, there is this really deeply savory sort of mouth-coating fullness to it. And that is the sensation of glutamic acid, especially when combined with salt. So we see it in Japanese cuisine. We see it in a lot of Asian cuisines, but we also see it a lot in Italian cuisine. It's a big part of like the tomatoes, the cured cheese, the cured meat. Those are all high in glutamic acid.
Right, the aged cheese, yeah, Parmesan.
Yeah, right. It was one of the highest. I think it's like 0.06% glutamic acid. Plus, it's very, very salty. So whether you're sprinkling on MSG or shaving Parmesan cheese, you're adding MSG into your food. You just are going to get different taste results from that, too. It's the idea of like sprinkling on salt versus adding something salty. It's different flavor profile. So part of what motivated me to write this chapter, too, is that I noticed this dissonance that we're calling not just the same taste, but the same compounds, the same chemical compound by two names. When we call it umami, it's high-end, it's new, it's modern, it is to be envied and replicated. And when we call it MSG, it still had the idea of being bad and bad for you and still associated with Chinese takeout.
Right.
The thing I want to say in closing about that too is I think that one of the reasons MSG got such a bad rap is because it was and is so heavily used within processed food. Because one of the things it does brilliantly is make food taste good, and it makes food taste good even if that food itself is bad. So we're looking at food that has other problems and other questions about it as whether it's nutritional or healthy, and MSG is associated with that. So it gets sort of wrapped up within that bad rap of that food. And I think that that's a huge issue. And I also just want to say, too, that the original studies about MSG done in the 70s weren't double-blind studies. People were being given MSG, and it was the study participants were people who had already self-declared to have a sensitivity to MSG. So there's a lot of bias within those studies. But every study done since that has been properly done as a double-blind study, there has been no difference between people consuming MSG and consuming the placebo. So it's time to sort of, there is even a certain amount of racism inherent with separating the idea of umami and MSG. They are the same thing and should be able to be used pretty safely interchangeably, that one shouldn't carry such positive cultural weight and the other such negative cultural weight when we're talking about the same thing, just in different contexts. So, you know, eat it when you want to or don't eat it, make the food choices you want to do, but we really have to analyze this sort of, to me, a bias and a xenophobic bend to using the word umami versus MSG within American culture.
I agree. Yeah, and that struck me as well. Like, wait a minute. MSG is bad. Umami is good. People.
Right. They're the same thing.
Yes.
So we just have to take a look at that. And, you know, if someone doesn't want to eat Chinese takeout because, I mean, there's the other thing that the sort of definitive study that was done in 1996, Tarasoff and Kelly about MSG, the one that really did double blind, did a good job and really looked at and said, okay, there's no difference between this and placebo. They pointed out that the idea Chinese restaurant syndrome or CRS has become a catch-all phrase that has been pinned to Chinese food and MSG when there are any number of irritants and allergens in something like Chinese food or takeout food.
Right.
Someone can be allergic to gluten, to soy, to shellfish. There is a high sodium content in, as we know, any sort of fast or processed foods. So these are all things that you can have allergies to, or it's very easy to consume too much salt when you're eating something like that as well. And even though those are all really unrelated to MSG, they're all things that have just been pinned on MSG and this idea of Chinese restaurant syndrome.
Mm-hmm. Right. There's so many aspects of this where it was ubiquitous in all these other foods, you know, restaurant foods, manufactured foods. I know some of the images that were shown partly during your session and during other sessions at the forum were showing like either products or packages of the home cook, the stay-at-home mom, the homemaker, you know, was encouraged to use these and they were enjoying them until all of a sudden, wait a minute, this is supposed to be bad. And, you know, again, it's not just in Chinese food, it's also in all these other foods.
No one has claimed to have Doritos syndrome. And Doritos, Kraft, KFC, and you can go online and Google it. All of these American companies are using monosodium glutamate. Mm-hmm. And that's not, to me, like a good or bad judgment call. You can make that call for yourself. Just don't sort of pin it on MSG.
Right.
I'll never forget one day when my roommates brought home, I can't remember what the product was called, honestly, but it was a seasoning for your vegetables. It was supposed to make them taste really amazing and really good. Mm-hmm. And she's like, yeah, I went to a cooking demo. It's so good. And I was like, all right, let me see that. What's in this bottle? And I picked it up, and what it said on the side was yeast extract. Mm. And yeast extract is what I might call a code word. It's an alternate word for monosodium glutamate.
Mm-hmm.
So even labels that you think don't have MSG in it, there are plenty of foods that we eat every day that is just using. I mean, again, let me put it this way. MSG is not synthesized in a lab. It's not a synthesized chemical. It is harvested as a result of fermentation processes. So many foods that have fermentation processes within them contain monosodium glutamate, like fish sauce, like soy sauce, like Vegemite and Marmite. That's what yeast extract essentially means. It's the byproduct of a fermentation, and the yeasts are just like pooping out glutamic acid, and you throw some salt in there, and you've got something that tastes amazing. So it's just people are scared of this white powder that gets added to their food, but that's like salt or like sugar, just what it looks like in its crystalline form. It can and does exist in many other ways, both in processed food and in totally made from scratch homemade food too.
Thank you for explaining that. And the dietitian in me also thinks about, as you were saying, you know, somebody feels that they have a sensitivity to MSG, but it could be a multitude of other things in that particular food that they're eating. And the dietitian in me wants that person to know, okay, you're having this symptom. Yeah, I'm listening. This is a thing. But the science shows that MSG doesn't cause this. So we might need to explore and find out what else you might be reacting to. Because if they just think it's MSG and they avoid MSG, but they're not really figuring out the underlying cause of whatever really is affecting them, then they're kind of missing the point.
Yes. And to be honest, by then avoiding foods that have MSG in it, you're probably avoiding whatever other allergen it might be. Or in most cases, it's sort of pinned to salt. So sure, if you avoid something like fast food or Chinese takeout, you're going to be avoiding foods that have a lot of sodium in them. And that's probably going to make you feel a lot better. You know, you'll eat something that's not going to make you feel sick after the meal. But yeah, all those ideas have been pinned on MSG. And that's just, as I've now looked at this research and revealed, it's kind of a real messed up cultural situation to talk about it in like less scientific terms, that it's really come from this really long history of both xenophobia and a fear of science.
Right. So that brings me to this question. We've talked about the history and this letter from 1968 and the increased consumption of MSG between the 30s and 60s. Everything that you've researched and everything that you're looking at in your current work, is the way we're eating continuing to change rapidly or slowly in recent history? Are you seeing any similar ingredients or foods or understandings or misunderstandings?
Sort of repeating history in terms of like what's happened
right.
with MSG with something else?
Right.
Yeah, I can kind of point to two examples that I think speak to the two sort of sides of it, the like fear of science and xenophobia. A couple years ago, I wanted to learn more about GMOs. You know, I kept hearing the term. I didn't really know what that meant. Much like when I'd ask people about MSG, people had this clear sense that they were bad, but really couldn't back that up. You know, I asked why, people didn't really have an explanation. So I went to a panel in New York that featured two people who were pro-genetic modification, pro-GMO, and two people who are anti. And I remember that one of the people on the panel was the science writer for the New York Times. The four all kind of presented their cases, and then they opened up to the floor to questions. And whereas the debate between the four people on the panel had been very like level and, you know, there were some disagreements, people in the audience were genuinely just yelling at the people at the panel. How can you say this is safe for us? It's been proven that it's not. It's been poisoning people. And the panelists had two really remarkable reactions that I remember more clearly than any other part of the panel. One of the people who was anti-GMO said, "Let me be clear. On this panel, I disagree that GMO is the best way to solve the world's health and food insecurity problem. It has been proven that GMO is not unsafe for the general population, that there is nothing dangerous about it. And that's not what either I or my colleague have come up here to argue." And then the New York Times science writer, she said, "You know, scientists call GMO the climate change of the left, because no matter how many facts we put out there and put in front of you and how many studies we show, you still don't believe us. You're still reacting with emotion. And so we look to the left to support us and support science fact. But when it comes to GMO, people don't seem to want to accept any amount of scientific fact that's presented."
Mm-hmm.
So as I look into my next book, at foods in America that are becoming endangered, and one of the foods I'm looking at is a type of citrus in Florida. One of the reasons it's going extinct is because of greening,
mm-hmm.
which is a disease that's affecting citrus in Florida. And one of the few ways we might be able to save not only this citrus variety, but the entire Florida citrus industry is by looking into GMOs and breeding trees that are resistant to greening.
Mm-hmm.
So I am really looking forward to getting into the nuts and bolts of what's going on, what the research says, and why we have this very emotional reaction, just in the same way that I saw those same sort of rumblings and emotions around MSG.
Mm-hmm.
So as far as like the next big battle and the place where I see the same fear that doesn't seem to be founded in fact is definitely GMO. And I think it's some of the same issues in that when I am talking to people about GMO, usually the reaction is, "Well, Monsanto uses it and they're horrible." And it's like, okay, great, feel that way about Monsanto. But keep in mind that that's not actually what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. I think of GMO as, well, like Superman can fly and he's a hero, but Magneto can fly and he's a villain. Does that make flying inherently good or evil?
Mm-hmm.
And so that is really the basis of what I'm looking at. GMO is a tool used by Monsanto, but also used by the University of Hawaii to save the papaya industry. So that's very, very different. So I see a lot of that in there. We have this tendency in America to both accept food before we accept the immigrant, but also using it to marginalize immigrants as well. Hummus is an item that has become an American everyday grocery item. You know, every grocery store you go to in here has hummus. People buy it regularly. And yet we have an active Muslim ban in this country, preventing people from those parts of the world from coming here. So we'll eat the food while at the same time rejecting the immigrant. So our relationship with immigrants represented by the foods that they bring here is still a really complicated one.
Yes, it seems very dysfunctional because you would think that if we're accepting the foods, that foods are such a great way to connect cultures and to experience cultures, that it would bring us together.
Right. And sometimes it does. And I think the best thing it can do is, a lot of times by having that experience, it does create empathy for other people. And I think that that is the best thing we can do as humans. And that's certainly what I wish we had more of in this country as a whole, welcoming people here who came here just like our ancestors and most of our ancestors, certainly mine. It seems wrong to me to turn around and say no to the next generation of immigrants.
Absolutely. I agree. You put it so well. And I think that is so important. The type of work you're doing, not only do you obviously love it, I think it's bringing some really important perspective to my field. As we were talking today, I couldn't help but think of two other episodes. If you've enjoyed this one, you might want to check out episode 90, where I interviewed Laura Kuman about the Hamilton cookbook. And Sarah, I don't know if you have had a chance to listen to that one yet, or if you are familiar with the Hamilton cookbook, but I got to meet the author in person when I was at a conference in DC. And when I hear you talk about these old cookbooks and these old recipes, it reminds me of the history, the exploration and research that she did, and just her fascination with the old recipes. So I'm going to connect you guys if you don't already, if you're not already connected.
Yeah. I'm definitely going to listen to that episode.
Oh my gosh. It was so much fun talking with her and just hearing her passion and how this came about. And the other episode that people might be interested in is way back to episode number 17, where I talk with food historian, and Sarah, this name is probably familiar to you. Her name's Rachel Loudon. And if you're not familiar, I'm going to send you her. She's written, I can't think of the name of the book that she wrote, but it's about culinary history. So those two people came to mind as having similarities to the type of work that you're interested in. And like I said, if anybody listening has enjoyed this episode, then they've got to check those out as well.
I think that looking at the past is a great way to understand where we came from. And when I'm looking at culinary history, I'm always trying to make connections to the present. So also, if anyone's listening and they're like, this doesn't sound like a culinary history episode, to me, it is this continuum of like, okay, well, what happened in the 19th century? How does that affect our decisions today? What happened in the early 20th century? And why does that mean we're eating such and such today? To me, it's the most important to make these contemporary connections, to provide context for our present day lives.
Absolutely. And in the book, I really encourage people to check out your book. There are some recipes in there that go with each of the different chapters, like, for example, black pepper brown sugar cookies. I'm sure you get into how and why you selected that. And, you know, you had mentioned in your introduction that one of the inspirations for you creating that pop-up restaurant for your thesis was that you went to this historical restaurant and you were very disappointed in what the menu offerings were.
Yeah.
You had mentioned you were looking for like beef a la mode with mace. And I made a recipe for beef a la mode with mace.
Cool.
You can still find it, but it was from Laura Kuman's Hamilton cookbook. She was surprised that I actually found whole mace at the spice house, not just ground.
Yeah.
But yeah, so when you, I was like, I know what that is.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's such a particular flavor of the 1840s, but it's still used a lot in Caribbean cooking. And you can also find it in like Indian spice stores. And yeah, for the book, I picked things that are authentic to different time periods that really showcase these ingredients, but also nothing too crazy in terms of preparation or finding ingredients. I wanted it to be accessible. And there are recipes in the MSG chapter, including how to make your own MSG at home. So have fun with that. And if anyone gives it a try, let me know. I'd love to hear from you.
Oh, wonderful. Yes. And that's something that I do have a lot of resources in the show notes at soundbitesrd.com. And my listeners know I'm not the most culinary person, so I do like specific recipes. I don't like to just kind of wing it in the kitchen. So we'll definitely share that. And of course, all the links to your books. And you're on social media, your Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at 4 pounds flour. And just in wrapping up, kind of bringing it full circle back to MSG and umami, what would be your bottom line takeaway for our listeners?
Bottom line takeaway is this. MSG has been proven to not be bad for you. There are no more ill health effects than if you are to overconsume table salt or sugar or drink too much. But in the end, to me, it's just sort of important to dispel that ignorance of pinning something called Chinese restaurant syndrome on MSG. But it's really not to encourage you to eat more or less of it. It's not a necessary nutrient. It doesn't really matter if you eat more of it. I just want people to do so knowing the whole story and to make decisions based on what they think tastes good and other health components rather than a fear of an additive.
Yes. And if somebody is very culinary, I encourage you to experiment in the kitchen with MSG. I had shared in another episode that we did a taste test with vegetable broth with sodium and vegetable broth with MSG, and the MSG one tasted so much better, and it actually had less sodium.
Yeah.
So people can experiment with scrambled eggs and simple things like that if they just want to kind of see for themselves.
That is a huge, huge, huge benefit, which is worth mentioning. Even though MSG itself is not necessary nutrients, it does contain less sodium than table salt while delivering a lot of flavor because it's giving you not just salty, but savory. So if someone is tasked with reducing sodium in their diet, consuming MSG can really help. It can really cut your sodium, I think, by almost a third. But I also have to say that just as a home cook too, I add fish sauce or soy sauce into almost every savory dish I make. Mm. You know, pot roast, or if I'm making a tomato sauce, or yeah, I throw a little soy sauce into my eggs in the morning. I also have just plain old MSG, the powder and a shaker on hand. But to me, like, soy sauce is this really nice way to add both the savoriness of MSG, but it's got a lot of other flavor compounds, chemical compounds in there that really round out the flavor. A little bit of soy sauce, I find, makes any sort of savory dish taste even more savory and even more delicious.
Mm, right. And going back to that whole flavor enhancement aspect of it, it's not just that you're making something saltier, you're doing the umami. So It's an umami bomb.
Exactly.
Well, thank you for sharing that. Clearly, you have a passion for food and history, and I just love it. I'm just so excited for your next book and the work you're currently doing and you'll be doing in the future. And I do want to say happy belated birthday.
Thank you.
I was checking out your social media, and that's quite a cake that your mom made for you, that princess cake.
Oh my gosh, the princess tort from the Great British Bake Off. It was a total surprise.
That's great.
Yeah, there's a video on my Instagram account where she's taking the first slice out, and we're all
oohing and aahing.
Screaming. Yeah, it's pretty amazing. You can tell where I get my interest in food and in history from. It's all my mom.
Yeah, I think you said it took her about 16 hours to make. I mean, that was a masterpiece.
16 hours.
She must love you a lot.
You know, she 100% does, but I knew that without the cake.
Of course.
She didn't
of
need
course.
The cake to prove it.
That's sweet.
She also pointed out that unlike on the show, she had to do all of her own dishes. So some of the 16 hours of making the cake
was washing
was
dishes. Great. Mm-hmm. Well, it caught my eye too. Of course, I mean, you can't miss it if you go on your Instagram page. It's really cool. But the whole fact that Sarah means princess.
Yeah.
And my daughter's name is Sarah with an H also. So
yeah,
it was interesting. But anyway, so happy belated birthday. And thank you so much for sharing all of your information and inspiration with us on the show today. And I look forward to staying in touch with you and connecting you with a few other maybe soul sisters that you can connect with.
Yeah.
And for everybody listening, as always, enjoy your food with health in mind. Till next time.
For more information, visit soundbitesrd.com. Music by Dave Burke.